Hey, what's up, guys? Jason here with Soulfire. Today, I'm going to bring you a book review. I want to review Nadia Bolt-Weber's book, Shameless, A Sexual Reformation, where she is calling the church to be reformed in the way we approach sexuality. So with the purpose of this channel to help you on your walk with sexual integrity, I want to answer the question whether this is a good resource for you or for your church. And so I'll break down the arguments that she has here. And if you stay tuned toward the end of the review, I'm going to tell you the one question you've got to answer to determine whether or not this book is for you. Now, maybe you're looking for some good resources, or hey, maybe you don't like to read books and you just want somebody to give you the Cliff Notes version. This review is for you. And ultimately, she is calling for a sexual reformation. Do I think the church needs to reform its handling of sexuality? Yes, I do. But at the end, I'll tell you why I don't think it's the exact conclusions that she is coming to and the reformation that she is asking for here. So let's jump in. Let's talk about our author, Nadia Bolt-Weber. I was not familiar with her work, but I had a friend recommend this book to me. He had some folks in his church that were reading it. He wanted to get my take, so I thought I'd put together this video review. Now, she is a former stand-up comic, recovering alcoholic, and she is a former pastor of a Lutheran church in Denver, a church that she founded, House for All Sinners and Saints. And so she's had some good success as an author. She's hit the New York Times bestseller list before. And so here, let's start jump in and break down some of the conclusions of her book, Shameless. Okay, so what's the premise of the book here? Ultimately, the premise of her book is that she wants you to be true to yourself, to be free to express your sexuality however you desire. She wants you to throw off any shackles or chains that have hindered your sexual expression. And so be true to yourself, be free to be yourself. And so a direct quote here from the book, she says, "Whatever sexual flourishing looks like for you, that's what I would love to see happen in your life." And ultimately, the only boundaries that she would place on sexual expression is anything involving minors, animals, or anything that would ultimately hurt those that you love. So where does our author get the authority to make these claims? Well, she makes it very clear that her authority comes from her life experience, her opinion, but ultimately it's from the interviews that she's had with those in her church. All right, reason number one for why she wants to see a sexual reformation in the church is that she said there was a lot of pain caused by the evangelical purity movement. When we talk about the purity movement, we're talking primarily 90s, early 2000s. It was a move by the evangelical church to promote sexual purity in rising promiscuity that was seen in the culture. And so to go over the evangelical purity movement, that is probably like a 20 or 30 minute video for another day. But I would just summarize it and say this: there were some good things that came out of the purity movement, a push toward biblical morality, but there was a lot of toxic legalism that was sown in the purity movement. And so I would say in a lot of ways, it was kind of like the prosperity gospel of sex. Do things God's way and He will bless you. And so many people were hurt by that, because one of the messages in the purity movement was, if you step out of God's design, if you step out of His boundaries, you're dirty, you are broken, and then we have kind of this pure and impure divide, that you are now impure, you are broken. And so unfortunately, the purity movement pushed a lot of rules on the younger generation, and it said, if you do this, you're pure, and if you don't do this, you're impure, and it left a lot of people with guilt and shame. And this is one of the reasons that her book is resonating with so many, because this is true. I totally agree with her that the purity movement caused a lot of pain and hurt. So issue number two for why our author, Nadia Bolt-Weber, says we need a sexual reformation in the church is that she says the church has often played the hypocrite and been like the Pharisees in terms of those who struggle with sexual sin. So she references John chapter 8, Jesus is presented with a woman caught in adultery, and the Pharisees say, hey, you know, this woman, according to the law, should be stoned. What do you say? And so she says the church has so often been like those Pharisees, where we've divided people into pure and impure. This again goes back to that evangelical purity movement. And we've wanted to throw stones at those who don't fully follow God's design for sexuality. And so ultimately Jesus does not throw stones at this woman. He's merciful to her. And he says, let those who are without sin be the first to throw stones. And so here, again, I would have to totally agree with her that the church has often been more like Pharisees than like Jesus, and we have wanted to throw stones, and this has caused people to be hurt and to be ostracized and to be pushed out from the church. And she shares her own personal story of how in the church that she grew up in, women were only valued based on their looks and what they could do for their husbands. And so as you read her story, and if this description of the church she grew up in is accurate, I would fully agree with her that it was a very toxic environment where women were really mistreated. They were not given the love and respect that I believe the scriptures call us in the church to love and respect women with. And so she came out of this very toxic environment. And so for those reasons, she's calling for a sexual reformation. Now, because of the nature of this channel and a lot of the subject matter that we typically cover, I wanted to include in this book review the author's take on pornography. And so she rightly sees how many people have turned to the easy access of pornography to numb the pain in their life. And she concludes, how could somebody be satisfied with their middle-aged spouse if they're filling their eyes, filling their mind with these computer-enhanced, surgically enhanced, perfect sexual experiences that you see through pornography? So she rightly concludes that certainly is gonna have an impact on your sexuality in marriage. But given the nature of the premise of her book, how she wants you to be free sexually, she stops short of saying, you know, pornography is not something that we in the church should be falling into. And she really leaves it to the couple. She says, hey, a lot of people I've talked to believe that pornography has enhanced their relationships. And so she basically says about pornography, let the couple decide. If this is something you want to use, if this is something that's helpful to you, go ahead and go for it. Now, given the premise of her book, she's staying consistent in that matter. So what is her conclusion from her book here? Where she says people have been hurt by the church, the evangelical purity movement. The church has divided people into pure and impure. As a result of that, she says we should throw off all rules and boundaries and people should be free to express themselves sexually however they want. Now, this is where I'm going to have to disagree. I agree with some of her premise for how she's gotten here, but to say we just throw all rules out the window, I don't actually believe that's where people are going to find life. So that brings me to the one question that you have got to answer if you're going to decide that you will side with the arguments here in this book or not. That one question is, who determines what is right or wrong? Is it man or is it God? Because if you believe that it's people who determine right or wrong, then you will agree with the arguments here in this book. Because ultimately, she says her authority is coming from what she believes and also from the interview she's had with people in her church. And granted, you hear the stories that she's written about folks in her church. They've been through many difficulties and they've experienced a lot of persecution, maybe from some toxic legalistic settings that they were in. So they've gone through a lot of pain, but do we then take that situation and say, well, we'll come together, we will determine what is right or wrong. We will decide what are the rules and boundaries of sexuality. If you go that route, especially in a religious context, you're really forced to throw out the Bible. You cannot blend those two ideas of we as people will determine what is right or wrong and biblical Christianity. They're not compatible. And so there's a story here in her book where one of her parishioners was very offended by the message of the scriptures. And this person began to rip out books of the Bible until she was left with only the Gospels. And here in the book, Nadia Bolt-Weber applauds that these books of the Bible were offensive to her, so she ripped them out so she wouldn't have to be offended by their message. At no point is the Bible going to advocate that you and I stay true to ourselves and live out the desires of our heart. I'll give you some passages as an example. Galatians 5:24, those who belong to Jesus Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Now, in the description of this video, I'll put some other passages, let you read for yourself. There are multiple examples in the scripture of how we need to not stay true to ourselves. We actually want to put to death those passions and desires that are into us. Now, most of those passages are actually from the epistles, and those are some of the books that her parishioner was ripping out, and she was saying, hey, we can avoid those. We don't need to use those. But in the gospels themselves, which is what her parishioner was left with, will you find there the message to stay true to yourself and live out your desires? You will not. In Luke 9:23, Jesus said, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. If you want to find your life, then you've got to lose it. So Jesus himself is not going to advocate that you and I live however we please and follow the passions and desires of our heart. Biblical Christianity is not compatible with the cultural notion of staying true to yourself, living out your heart. In fact, it's the opposite. It's telling us to put to death those desires that we have in our heart, to reject all of those, to not follow what we desire, but to ultimately submit those to God and what He desires. But as I conclude this book review, there's one issue I want to address that the book talks about, and it talks about the idea that the church has very often divided people into two camps, the pure and the impure. And I think the evangelical purity movement really did that. It pushed this message that if you do these certain things God's way, then you're pure and you got to guard your purity. And if you don't, then you're impure. And it used guilt and shame to kind of push people down. I actually don't believe that's what the Bible teaches. I don't believe that the Bible teaches there are two groups of people. And so here's a quote from the book. She says, if you were to draw a circle that represents all the people on the planet, and then inside it, draw another circle to represent the people who live according to God's plan, then, well, very few people on the planet would fit into that circle. And what I would actually say is what I believe the gospel teaches is that none of us are in that circle of living according to God's plan. The message of the scripture is that there is none righteous. None of us can say we are pure. We are all broken. We are all sexually broken. That's why Jesus had to come. None of us can say to God that we've lived your plan, we've done it perfectly, we by our hands have earned righteousness, and we can be with you. The message of the gospel is that we are all broken, and that's why we desperately need Jesus. And so I believe the church needs to get behind that. We can't divide people into pure and impure. We can't say to one group of people that you are sexual sinners. And so in that story that she references in John chapter 8, the reason that the religious leaders shouldn't throw stones at the woman caught in adultery is that they too deserved to be stoned. Jesus said, let the one who's without sin be the first to throw a stone. But remember the words that Jesus left her with. He said, I do not condemn you. Go and sin no more. He offered her that gift of non-condemnation. The punishment she deserved, that we all deserved, Jesus would take. He would pay for her sins and my sins on the cross. That's the beauty of the gospel. None of us are pure. All of us are impure and desperate and needy for Jesus. So do I think the church needs a sexual reformation? Well, actually I do, but I don't think it's the one that Nadia Bolt-Weber is advocating for here in her book, Shameless. And I want to recommend two resources for you that cover the same issues that Nadia Bolt-Weber has here in her book, but come to different conclusions. The first one is a book by Julie Slattery called Rethinking Sexuality. She talks a lot about the evangelical purity movement. She talks about how culture has this narrative on sexuality, and she comes to different conclusions. Highly going to recommend that book. But the last one I want to talk about that addresses a number of the claims that are here in this book, Shameless, is a book called Guiding Families. And in this book, by a ministry called Lead Them Home, I believe they are going to propose the sexual reformation that we need in the church. And that reformation is this, that the church needs to radically love people the way that Jesus did. The church should not be throwing a message of condemnation, dividing groups into pure and impure. Rather, we should be saying that we are all sexual sinners. We are all desperately needy for Jesus, and we should not be ostracizing certain groups of people. Highly recommend the book, Guiding Families. Well, thanks so much for watching. If this review was helpful, click the subscribe button down below and ding that notification bell. Like this video, share it with a friend or two. I'd really appreciate it. It'll help me with my channel. Thanks so much. Have a good one.